shadows of the alleys.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Salem Baptist Church. I'm so glad you're here this morning to worship Jesus. I have a couple announcements for you. The first thing I want to mention is I am off delivering the gift bags to children, and it's been a blessing. I'm super excited about doing that. So if you know any children in our church that would like me to stop by and give them a coloring book, devotional, and some different things about the miracle of Jesus is the theme for the gift bags. I love to come by and see the kids and love on them and pray for them and encourage them. So please let me know. You can email me or text me or any way you like to communicate through social media. This past week in youth group, we did Ultimate Frisbee Wednesday. And the theme was, is a Frisbee when you throw it. We guessed maybe a Frisbee might stay in the air 3 seconds max the way we were playing. Maybe 10 seconds for like the pros. But then, interesting fact, eagles can be up in the air soaring for up to 86 hours. And so the verse I shared with the students was Isaiah 41:31. It says this, "But those who hope in the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint." And I told them, I said, we shouldn't be focused on fads and temporary things, but that we should be focused on the Lord because He is our strength and we can soar for hours with Him because He is an awesome, awesome God that deserves our focus. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to focus on things that are temporary. I want to focus on things that last forever, and that's Jesus Christ and the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thanks so much. Pastor Kevin?
He's got so many more now, I don't need to be over here because I'm wearing one. See, the mic's there, and never mind. So, good morning, good to see everybody. I hope you are surviving the continued stuff. Appreciate those of you that are spread out and that are doing the precautions, and let's keep doing that. I'd love to kind of test the, you know, everybody says, oh, we can eradicate it in 2 weeks. You know, maybe if we all hold our breath. What if the whole world held its breath for 2 minutes? I don't know. But keep doing the safety precautions. Wash your hands. Wear your mask if you're able. Keep distanced, and maybe we can do something with this thing. A couple of prayer concerns updates to make you aware of. We're going to pray after we sing. Some of you, well, none of you, I think, when I was out there and checked right before we started, the lectern was there with a sign with red letters and 72. Okay, so what do you think that means? Piece of paper on the lectern in the hall with red ink on your way in. Do you think you were supposed to notice it? So either none of you have anything to pray about or you didn't slow down enough to read it. Because that's what it said was, we're going to try a new thing for prayer requests. And we're going to get you to come by and grab a pen, jot them down for several reasons. One, we have the folks that are online and listening. They don't hear y'all when you share one. And then if I repeat it, and then all of a sudden we just start getting really long, long, long because everything's doubled. So we're going to try this and see. So in essence, the piece of paper is like you sending it to Shannon. And we're really going to talk to our technology people too and see if they can't either make the television or one of the screens be like the feedback for what Shannon sees during the service while folks are logged on or with their prayer concerns or they're saying, hey, Salem, or hey, friends, or see all you people like me. Wouldn't you love that during church? You could sit there and just keep scrolling going, yeah, oh, cool. What? No, huh? Okay. The rest are cool. But find ways to stay connected in this new day. A friend of mine pastors a church up in Northern Virginia, 600 to 800 people before Sunday back with trying to do anything. We're hopeful. They're following the rules in that they actually had people register and sign up online to come. The idea behind that is if one of you calls the office this week, says you test positive, we have to go back and try to figure out who was there so we let you know, so that we could let you know who was positive in case you encountered or talked to or breathed on or were breathed on by the, you know how that works. Anyway, point of that story was, I think his numbers are about right. He had 200 register. They're probably going to have 150 or so show up. It seems like, and it's bearing out for us, about 25% of the church is regathering in churches that are regathering. Online, virtually everyone has seen this huge plummet in the online numbers. It's not just us. If you look and you see probably right now, I don't have ours. Does it say how many are logged on now, Shannon? Like 3? 10? 30. All right. Big day. Go online Salem. That's awesome. And you're going, wait a minute. Wasn't it like 6? What? Wasn't it like, you know, hundreds before when this first started? And it was. So what does that tell us? I have no idea. Because during the week, people watch. And maybe the 50 that are here. So you put 50 and 40, you're up to 90. But we were in the 500s showing up on those numbers. Now, some people just go back and watch because the service is so engaging. And they want to watch it every day for a week. And I'm teasing. But no, they kick off the internet and they come back on. Here's an announcement for what I hope will be our fall norm. And for those of you that are online, we're glad you're here. We're glad you're a part. I'm going to challenge you to pray about and think about. You don't want to be in a crowd of 50, and I get that. And you might not want to leave your home, but some folks that are kind of staying close to home have started to at least reconnect with some family, or they've reconnected with some friends, but they're not out in big numbers. So consider inviting some friends and do a live watch party with a couple of families or a couple of couples that get together intentionally to worship together, just not on site. Do you catch why I'm inviting you to do that online, church? I've tried it the couple times when I'm not here to do online church by myself. Or just Brenda and I, or something. But you know, you get up and I don't do coffee, but I'll get up and go get some more water or bathroom break or whatever. It's just, you're not as engaged, but I think if we gather with some friends and the intention, the reason for gathering is to worship, we might worship more, maybe. Pray on that. That's what's going to be, I think, nudged and encouraged as we get through the summer and toward the fall. Okay, let me give you a couple prayer concerns to think about while we sing, and then we'll pray after we sing. Craig Beasley is the pastor of Shiloh Baptist Church. His wife just got out of the hospital, and now he's in, and that's all I know, but we need to be praying for him. Craig is a great guy right there on Main Street in Bowling Green, but be prayerful for him and his family. I don't know if it's COVID-related or not. Frank Cecil is doing much better. He had a heart transplant a couple weeks ago. They've removed a whole lot of things. They're weaning him off the vent. Angie's response to it said that he needed to stop doing his recovery in Cecil time. And what she was saying was slow motion. So, but he's doing much, much better. Continue to pray for him and for her. She's in Charlottesville kind of doing that solo, and the boys are here doing their thing. Randy Newsom continues his battle. Continue to be prayerful for him. Terry Roseman and her family, those of you on Facebook have followed that, or she shared that concern last week. Just pray for her family and their continued walk through the grief and the loss of her brother unexpectedly. Lynn Thomas is home. She's still recovering, having some pain and stuff. Continue to pray for her. And then one close to home, some of you ladies are in Bible study and stuff with Susan Smith. Susan had a fall, fractured couple of vertebrae. And was med-flighted from the church parking lot at 2 a.m. Saturday morning early, I think. So be prayerful for her. The surgery went well. She's at MCV. John sent me a text response, said he'd call later, but said that he was on his way down, and I don't know if he can get in yet to see her or just what that is. But apparently surgery went well, and they're just praying for numbness and full range of motion with everything to clear up. So be prayerful for them. Okay? Since you didn't check the sheets, I'll go ahead and we'll let you do a couple. Any couple of prayer concerns to add to that? I did not know that. William Roy Southworth's wife passed away yesterday. Be prayerful. Beverly, be prayerful for him and their family. We need rain desperately. It's not supposed to crunch when you walk across the yard. Yeah, absolutely. Teachers, students, that mass of humanity in an enclosed space. Yeah, be prayerful. All right, let's worship the Lord, and we will. Thank you. Yes, Bailey Brooks had her baby, Caden. Thank you. Still at the hospital, 2 pounds and 12 ounces, so tiny baby, a couple months early, but so far so good. And that's those of you that have had to leave your baby in a NICU, you know how hard that is for her to come home and baby stay. So be prayerful for them. The Brooks family was part of Salem a while ago. The girls did some youth group and stuff here. So a lot of y'all know David and Amanda. All right, let's stand and worship the Lord, and we will wrap up with prayer.
All right, so I hope you're all ready to sing this morning because we need a little help with this first one. This is what has been referred to by the Gaither Vocal Band as a 100-year-old worship song. Probably most of you know it because it's in the hymnal, but this is a country version of it. And as you know, I'm from San Diego, so country is not really what I do. And Juan is from Puerto Rico, so they don't do country there either. So we're going to need lots of audience participation for this song this morning. But I think you'll like it, and it's a great song, and I love these days, in this day and time, to sing about victory. Amen. Anytime I can, because the world is full of anything but right now, so sometimes it's good for us to think about what's coming. Amen?
Amen.
All right, let's do it.
I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary, to save a wretch like me. Come on. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior.
Amen.
weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. Sing it with us, church. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, oh, oh. Yeah. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will. Oh, I'm not backing down from any giant. I know how this story ends. Yes, I know how this story ends.
Come on.
I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. See your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
Sing it with us.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good.
Oh, you
turn it for good.
Come on, church.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Sing it out.
I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. The enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
Amen. How many of you believe that God can take what the enemy means for evil and use it for good? Amen. Because he is our living and holy God.
The hosts of heaven. Who else could make every king bow down? Who else can whisper and darkness trembles? Only a holy God. What other beauty demands such praises? What other splendor outshines the sun? What other majesty rules with justice? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the What other glory consumes like fire? What other power can raise the dead? What other name remains undefeated? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the who else could rescue me from my failing? Who else would offer his only son? Who else invites me to call him Father? Only a holy God. Only my holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. Come behold him.
One more time.
Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the
two other prayer needs as we go to the Lord in prayer. One was from Sue Whittle. Katie and their family's having twins, Avery and Finn. And then Sally Akers solved one of the blue line motorcycle groups, I guess, was doing a ride, and a drunk driver hit somebody in that and killed them. So be prayerful there if you would. So let's pray. Almighty God, we thank you that as we share needs and concerns as a family of faith, we thank you for the wonders of technology so that church family can be a part of the service and share needs and concerns, and that those who are gathered can share those needs and concerns. And Father, those that will watch during the week because they were somewhere else in this moment. Father, we're grateful that you're a God who binds us all together regardless of what a disease can do and change our normal patterns. Father, as we gather today, I just pray that you would speak to our hearts and help us to look inside, because today's message really challenges us to seek you and your wisdom, but Father, to make your salvation what drives our and informs and speaks to our intellect and to our emotion, and calls us to touch that part of ourselves that is the eternal part, that soul that is within us, that is not merely emotion, and it's not merely what we know. Father, it's something much deeper and fuller and truer. So God, I just pray that you'd speak to our hearts and talk to us this morning. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can have a seat if you're not already. Read a story this week about a fella in the Army. Humvee was hit by a IED. There's an accident, flipped the vehicle. He had on the new high-tech helmets, whatever they're called. As a lot of soldiers do, I never was one, but those of you that were might concur whether this is true or not. Taking marches and hikes in full gear that I think some have said can weigh up 80 pounds or more, you complain about that when you're just doing it for fun to get ready. But when he was in the hospital, somebody had brought that helmet to him from the accident, and he found why that kept him alive, as the helmet was mangled and bent, but because of the technology, including the padding and the strength of that helmet, he was still alive and not crushed and gone on to be with Jesus. He learned the wisdom of wearing the protective gear, that the helmet mattered. And as we're continuing this walk through Ephesians chapter 6, we've talked about all the pieces, and we're going to talk about the helmet of salvation. Use every piece of God's armor to resist the enemy in the time of evil, so that after the battle you'll still be standing firm. Stand your ground, putting on the sturdy belt of truth, the body armor of God's righteousness. For the shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news, so that you may be fully prepared. In every battle, you'll need faith as your shield to stop the fiery arrows aimed at you by Satan, and put on salvation as your helmet. The helmet's the last of the protective gear mentioned in the passage. Helmet. Some of you are old enough maybe to remember watching the old newsreels. See how I saved myself from that? I don't know if any of you watched the NFL back in the day before it was a political organization. And back in the day, they didn't wear hardly any helmet. And then they started wearing just kind of like this leather cap that had a little padding on it, you know. And now they wear this engineered helmet that has some open flaps so that when you hit, they absorb the force and the whole concussion protocol and all that stuff. I played a very little bit of football, and I was on the line. I didn't have a lot of the high-speed impacts because I was up there where the big grunts just kind of got in the trenches and tried to drive the other one back. Very little bit. If I accomplished my job as a guard, most of the time it meant I either kept that guy from moving or I moved him 6 inches or I just had to make a little scene. But then you get back in with the linebackers and the defensive backs and wide receivers and running backs, and you got these guys who are chiseled and built and 210 to 230, 40 pounds that are running 4.45s coming at each other, bam. And you'll know they get right, protocols, they change the spearing because the helmet became a weapon at that speed with that much bulk, nailing people, and they're trying to make the game safer. Can you imagine playing football today without a helmet? When I'm on the road and I drive by the crazy people on motorcycles without a helmet in the states that don't require that, I'm like, what is wrong with you people? Now, some of you bikers are probably, yeah, it's great because you're free in the air in your hair and bugs in your teeth. And man, I hated the guys that run 95. Craig's old crazy people on BMWs that run thousands of miles on a weekend. I don't get it, but when I was out there, I'd want everything. I like wanted a big balloon around me, like something, because it's people are crazy and there's just nothing there. A helmet can be a good thing. And it's used, and it's called the helmet of salvation for a reason. And we're going to talk about that. Wisdom matters. And this use of a helmet as the thing that kind of protects the most important part, right? I mean, lots of stuff goes wrong if you hurt your head. That little 4 or 5 pounds of gray matter that's between your ears, it does a lot. And that's why you've got this bone-encased protection around it. But so the other day I was working in the barn cleaning up stuff and working on some stuff, and I changed the oil on the Tiguan, and it was great to lay on the cool concrete. It was like, this feels really good, because I was all sweaty and gross, and then you lay on the cool concrete. I didn't want to get up. But I sat up one time and I leaned back to get something, and you tap the concrete a little, just a tap. I didn't hit it hard. But it hurt. The concrete's even harder than my head, okay? I ran into the bucket of the tractor a couple years ago, and I used to be able to find it. There it is, right here. I've got this ledge where the staples, you know, they staple you back together. They make this bump. I'm glad I've still got hair up there, because when the time comes and I have to join some of y'all, Scott Stanley, when I have to do that, it'll be ugly. It'll be this big line right up there from where I stood up, and bam! And you can call my little tractor a little toy tractor Gale Terry all you want, but my little toy tractor's bucket is quarter-inch steel, and it doesn't move, even when I run into it. The head needs protection. The brain needs protection. And so when we start talking metaphorically and using this helmet of salvation, the helmet is the illustration for salvation, and we're going to talk about wisdom, the wisdom that comes from knowing that the Lord is our salvation. How does that protect everything? Think about it. It protects everything. And that's what we're going to talk about today. If you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, Jesus is the wisdom we need. Let me talk about wisdom. I mentioned it in the prayer. I don't have any scientific study to put on this, but I think there is something to wisdom that we don't always get. We all understand that wisdom isn't knowledge. Knowledge is knowing lots of stuff. And there are a lot of people that know a lot of stuff about the Bible and about God, and they love telling you how much they know. Anybody know those people? I know some. Want me to give you some names? I know some of those people. And they can spout off with knowledge. You go, ooh, they're using those words I can't even think about spelling. And that's great. I'm all for knowledge. Not a thing wrong with knowledge. But knowledge and 99 cents plus tax will get you a Diet Coke at McDonald's. Right? How about emotion? Any of y'all know people that are very emotional? Cry at the drop of a hat, get mad at the drop of a hat, laugh uproariously at bad jokes, because their emotion is just so close to the surface. You know those people? That you just wonder, how did they fly off the handle that far over that? Anybody, two of you are not. Are the rest of you with me today? If we're going to be back doing church together, y'all got to be engaged, okay? I don't want to go back to that empty room, but if you're just going to sit there like a bump on the log, then join in online or something. I don't know. Just kidding. There'll be 12 people here next week. I know. But so there's this head thing, and there's knowledge. And then there's this emotion thing. And we know how that... Oh, sorry. We know how that kind of pans out sometimes. And sometimes folks don't feel like they've worshipped or encountered God unless they have this emotional response. Unless there are tears or joy, that smile on their face that they can't, like it hurts their face to smile that big. And unless they have some emotion involved with their time with God, that they didn't have a good time with God. And unless some other folks have some deep thought that causes them to go, they feel like they haven't encountered the Lord. Now there's nothing wrong with those moments or those joyous moments that involve emotion and involve the intellect. Engage them all. My contention is wisdom is something beyond both of those. And it's beyond the two of those put together. And it's not just knowing how to act with the knowledge you have. That's a piece of it. But there is something about the wisdom that comes from God and the wisdom that is the salvation that's provided to us through Christ Jesus that is more encompassing, more engaging, more touching than just wisdom, than just intellect or emotion. That's what the, I'm done, you can go home now. That's pretty much where I wanted you to get for the day. I want us to understand that God calls us to more than just having the right intellect or the right emotion. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, Romans 12:2, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you'll know what God wants you to do, and you'll know how good and pleasing His perfect will is. God wants to change what goes on in our gray matter. He wants to not only teach us more stuff and not only teach us how to use the more stuff, but He wants to do it by changing our lives and our hearts with Christ. And that changes everything. Some of us want wisdom and we want it now. Can I tell you, you're an unwise person. Wisdom takes time. Golfers, you probably know the guy I'm going to mention, Harvey Penick. He taught, he was the coach for the golf team in Texas or somewhere, I think, for like 35 years or something. And he got really good at watching people and fixing their swings and training and all that stuff. You know when his book about golf was published? When he died. Or just before he died. A golf writer found and saw that he took notes on everything. And so his, I think it's called The Little Red Book. And now you talk to any golf teaching pro and Penick's name will come up. Google golf lessons and you'll learn something about Penick and his methods for teaching and changing the way we play the game of golf. If he wrote the book in the 31 or something when he started being a coach, would anybody want it? The book was written at the end of his career. Golf is a game that is more than knowing what you're supposed to do and the physical ability to do it. There is this weird something with golf, and some days you got it and some days you don't. And the ball goes, it's just, it's weird. I love watching the pros duff one in the woods. The guys that make $1 million playing golf for a living can still hit it in the water or the woods. It is such a graceful moment for me to watch that happen. Because I spend most of my time in the woods, and if there's water anywhere, I can find it. Wisdom is about practice. Wisdom is about learning to apply God's presence and God's will and God's movement in our lives to a current situation. It's that having lived through life and seeing God move and work, that when we come to a circumstance that naturally makes us just want to fly off the handle if we're driven toward the emotion, or just makes our brain hurt because it makes no sense to us, but we've watched God move when it didn't make sense. And we've watched God move when His emotion didn't line up with ours. And God changes us. Right? Anybody else been there? Let me lay it out for you a little clearer for our current circumstance. Does anybody with today's world and you watch the news have trouble getting mad about something? Anybody? Okay, Scott, fine. When we watch, it's not hard, is it? How about this? For those of you who don't get angry easily, do you have any trouble watching the news and becoming more despairing over current realities? Have I covered everybody yet? I want everybody to be a part of this, okay? Is God despairing? Is God's anger ever misguided? What if God gets angry about something other than what you're angry about? Hello. What if God's not angry about the things that infuriate you? Who are you going to go with? You or God? The wisdom that comes from the putting on the helmet of salvation, Christ's salvation, new life in Christ, says, God, make me angry about the things you're angry about, and help me let the other go. Somebody say ouch with me, because that truth hurt me this week. Ouch. Three of you. Okay, well, at least I'm connecting with three people in the congregation today. Wisdom brings perspective. And the only perspective that matters to us as believers is His. And not His that we work hard to theologically cover. On either side of it, I got Christian friends that are on both sides of this mess we've got. With COVID and with race, and they will make the biblical case for both sides of it. And they don't have any trouble doing it. They'll tell me how wrong anybody who disagrees with them is. What if God's perspective isn't theirs? Huh? Do you want to be leading the charge? And find out God says, not my plan. See, wisdom takes time. Wisdom takes experience. Wisdom takes some miles on the tires. Because we've seen God move and work before. Wisdom takes an openness. One of my kids challenged me on some stuff with current events, and we were going, and it really surprised me how much they thought differently of what I thought from the story they made up, because we hadn't talked. And they just assumed. And as we talked, there was this eye-opening season. I'm like, wow. If they got that wrong, how might everybody else? Do we crave wisdom and God's perspective? Sometimes we think when we have a word from the Lord, we're done. Sometimes when we get a glimpse of glory and it's confirmed by His word and by the people we respect in the faith and they speak wisdom into our lives, got it. That's great, but that word might be for right now. He might have a new word for you tomorrow. Not that's in contradiction to that. See, when did the plan for the 40 years? Go back. You remember that time when God called him up to the mountain and God rained down fire and he handed out the map and told him everything that was going to happen for the next 40 years. You remember that? Somebody try to look it up. You're not going to find it, right? Because what did he do with Moses? Moses had to get up every day. And there was the fire by night. You remember? How frustrating would that be every day for 40 years with all the complainers going, well, what are we doing now, Moses? Right. Moses, well, we'll wait on the Lord tomorrow. Wait on the Lord. Tired of waiting on the Lord. Man, I'm getting old. I've been out here wandering around. And you keep saying we're going to blah, 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 blah. The Lord's brought us this far. He'll get us there tomorrow. Can you imagine how we would respond in 2020 with that kind of a God? It's that kind of God, people. Wisdom comes day by day, and wisdom comes moment by moment. And I bet you most of you in this room have sweated a decision and prayed about it and not known and wanted the whole picture. And then all of a sudden God gave you a glimpse and you knew what you needed to do tomorrow. And you did it. Right? And there's that peace. And then we get greedy and say, great God, you got me that one. Now tell me the rest. And he says, I will. When you need to know. None of y'all are looking very fulfilled by the message. But that's the way it goes. Because why? We have to trust God every day. if we think we got it all figured out, then we'll become those arrogant jerk Christians that nobody wants to be around. Right? I know some of them. Do you? Don't have y'all point your finger up here. I try hard not to be. Wisdom's about being patient. Some of y'all probably have some retirement money or investment money, maybe, if you still have any of that left, given the chaos we're in. But you know a name, John Templeton. The Templeton funds are still a pretty solid investment tool that a lot of folks still use. He borrowed 10 grand a long time ago and invested it, and 4 years later, he had quadrupled his money. And that started him on this. Now he's one of the greatest benefactors of charities and wealthy man, well-respected. He's gone, but his funds still live. But he used the wisdom that he gained and was patient. So how do we get wisdom? So we can wrap this thing up. How does an overcomer, which has been our theme, get wisdom? The Proverbs are a great place to start. Here's a couple just to whet your appetite. Happy is the man who finds wisdom and the man who gains understanding. For wisdom is better than rubies, and all the things one may desire cannot be compared with her. When wisdom enters your heart and knowledge is pleasant to your soul, discretion will preserve you. Understanding will keep you. Oh, golly, can we make a banner and put it up on 95 with some of this? Maybe we get one of those changing ones and we just put a proverb up every day? I don't know. How do we acquire wisdom? Here's another truth, I think. In this walk with Jesus, we get about as much Jesus as we truly want. I think that's true of God's wisdom too. We get as much of God's wisdom as we truly want and seek. There's a song that I probably shouldn't play because it's a couple minutes long, but that's okay. It's a country music day. I don't know why that is. But so this song popped up on my playlist, and Lauren Daigle and Reba McEntire. I don't listen to much Reba, y'all. So it just popped up, though, because I listened to Lauren Daigle, okay? And she doesn't sing in it much. But listen to this song for today and listen to the passion in the chorus about how we have to go hard after God. Okay, but the part that is we, you and me, got to give our parts of this world back to the Creator God. The only way we're going to fix any of this mess is to have the wisdom enough to say it's all got to go back to Him. Right? I'm not picking a side. I'm not picking on anybody. I'm not saying you're entitled to opinion. I'm not going there at all. I'm just saying we need to hit the floor praying at least as much as we're doing anything else. How do we get this wisdom? How do we latch on to it? And I so am going to learn to write neater because I have some really good notes in the margins and I can't find some of them enough to read them now. But anyway, first thing we have to develop is a humble spirit. A humble spirit. A humble spirit. A humble spirit. Fear the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. I hate how many times I despised wisdom and instruction coming through school. That means I'm a fool. Behold, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom, Job said. The indefinable mixture of reverence, fear, pleasure, joy, and awe which fills our hearts when we realize who God is and what He has done for us is what the fear of God is. It's that overwhelmedness. It's beyond what we come to know and go, aha, this is genius. It's beyond going, God, and crying out in tears and falling flat on our face. It's something that combines the intensity of both of those and hits at a deeper spot that's at the core of who we are that I think we call the soul. It is that peace that lasts beyond, that connects with God. But we have to be like Paul and realize who's sufficient for these things of God. And we have to come before Him humbly and realize He has the answers and we don't. Billy Graham used to tell a story a long, long time ago about the the president or the chairman of the board of the company, one or the other, and that I guess was the president of the company, the guy, he was doing the day-to-day work, but everyone does that. And his secretary blocked off the first 30 minutes of the day. He took no appointments. Nobody opened the door to his office because he was on his knees praying about his life, his family's life, the business, the world. It was his time with the Lord, and she guarded it. And the chairman or whoever the other big guy was came barging in because he had a disaster going on and he needed to know something. She said, "Sir, you can't go in. Sir, you can't go in." And he barged right on in anyhow. And he found the other guy on his knees praying, and he locked the door, and he came back out, and he goes, "What's going on in there?" She said, "That's how he starts his day every day." And the guy was humbled because he said, "No wonder I come to him for advice." Hello? Second thing we need is a hungry soul. That line a few minutes ago of saying we get as much Jesus as we really want. We get as much of God's salvation as we really want. How much you pursue and how hungry you are in the pursuit is what brings you to God. In Psalm 119, six different times, we're told to seek God or keep God's testimony. Listen to with our whole heart. Listen to Him. Keep God's testimonies with our whole heart. Seek God's commandment with our whole heart. Obtain God's word with our whole heart. Entreat God's favor with our whole heart. Keep God's precepts with our whole heart. Cry unto God with our whole heart. We are so busy, and I shouldn't say we. I can stay so busy and so distracted by so many things. There are only moments in my life when it's a whole heart pursuit. Not divided loyalties like I want to run after Satan or something. It's just the reality of the world we live in and the distractions we have. How often do you pursue God with your whole heart, your whole being, your whole anything? Right? It's hard. I can tell you, I stink at it. Hard to carve out that time. Or at least I make an excuse that it is. I don't know about you. Maybe y'all don't. But when we miss it, when we're not spiritually hungry, when we don't feed spiritually, the same thing happens as when we don't eat food physically. Some of y'all get so busy in your day and you don't eat. Some of you are going, "Who gets so busy they don't eat?" But some people do. Some people do. And they talk about they get hungry and they get weak. And then you start feeling like you don't even want to eat, right? How many of you have gotten sick with the flu or with something and you've not eaten for a while? And it's like, nothing sounds good to me. You can tell that's not my experience, but I know of people who that's their reality. Well, the same's true of God's stuff. That's why COVID is so worrisome to people of faith when they look around. They realize, are my peers, my friends, my family, are they engaging with Jesus now? Are they worshiping somewhere? Are they feeding at His table? Not that just attending church or just being in small group or just doing what we've always done covers it. It doesn't. It can be rote. It can be a habit. It can be almost meaningless. But for many, it is a part where they reconnect with God, and being with God's people when they reconnect with God encourages, inspires, challenges them to keep reconnecting with God and finding ways to serve God together, because we're in this together because we are the body of Christ. And right now we got a bunch of disjointed parts in the body and it's hard to figure out how to be one. Because the longer it takes 28 days to make a new habit. Are we into month 4 or 5 now of this? Church is going to have to relaunch, y'all. Granted, we got a crowd now that some churches never had pre-COVID. We're blessed. But a lot of us can remember 300 people being here with 2-packed services. We're a long way from there. How are we going to do that? Do we just say, "Oh, well, they walked away, that's on them"? Yep, my pancreas walked away. I don't need it anymore. That's another sermon for another day. A hearing heart. We got to be willing when God speaks to listen, whether we like it or not. A wise man will hear and increase in learning. A man of understanding will attain wise counsel. To understand a proverb and an enigma, the words of the wise and their riddles. Listen to counsel and receive instruction that you may be wise in your latter days. Incline your ear and hear the words of the wise and apply your heart to my knowledge, for it is a pleasant thing if you keep them within you. Let them be fixed upon your lips. Again, wisdom from the Proverbs. But we have to train ourselves to listen, don't we? Anybody else can act like you're listening to somebody and not hear a thing they say? Do we need to switch to marriage enrichment 101? Spouses, how many times do you have to say to your mate, what'd you say? Because you caught a little piece of it and you thought, uh-oh, that might have been important. I should have really been listening. Anybody? Okay. How about parents? When your chatterbox preteen just goes, and you go, that's nice, dear. Go play. We have to work at listening. How much harder is it to listen to God, who's not flesh and blood in front of us talking? One man said, a wise man talks because he has something to say. Fools talk because they have to say something. Ouch! Another guy said, we gather knowledge when we listen. We spend it when we teach. But if we spend before we gather, we'll soon be bankrupt. Oucher! Mm. Here's the hardest one, and then we're done. So a humble spirit says, I need God. A hungry soul says, I desire God. A hearing heart says, I'll listen to God. And the last one that Dr. Jeremiah mentioned in the book was a heeding mind says, I will obey God. Charles Barkley said in Experiencing God, when do we experience God? When we take that step of obedience. All the rest is pregame. We experience God's presence when we take that step of faith. Until then, it's all preparation, it's listening, it's hearing, it's praying, it's getting ready. But when we step out in faith, we experience the presence of God. It's a heeding, it's a heart that says, God, I want to do what you've called me to do. What good is it for us to know everything about God and not act on it? What good is it for us to think we know the heart of God, but we still choose our way over His way? What good is it for us to have heart and mind together and are a put-together Christian package, but when God speaks, we go, I don't like that. In these troubled times, in the utter chaos that is our world right now, politically and racially and systematically, with people putting forth plans for crazy social options that don't have a prayer of working, the world needs for some God people to rise up and speak wisdom and truth. And to speak wisdom and truth with love so that people will actually listen. I struggle with this. It is easy to talk. This afternoon, I got to hurry up because we got to do Sunday school online. And then I'm driving down. Four friends are getting together from high school. All four were in our wedding. I see one of them a lot because he's Corey's father-in-law. And I see another one a lot because they live close to this one. So we get together when we see Greg, Corey's father-in-law, and Randy. And then there's Grant. Grant and all this racial garbage, I got to second-guessing friendship from high school. So at 2 in the morning when I sometimes wake up and then I can't get back to sleep, if you can wake up and keep your brain turned off, I have no problem going back to sleep. But if I wake up and a thought enters my head, I'm done. And it can be 2:30 or 4 or 7, but if a thought enters, it's like it turns the switch, and then it's like, wham, wide open throttle for the rest of the morning. Gee, 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 gee. I try to distract myself with music, or I'll put on a show on the thing, and I'll try to just and fall asleep, and now they just... And so one of them was, I'd been reading and stuff, and this thing came up, and I got it all in my head. So I sent this long old text at 3 in the morning because I knew he'd be asleep. He calls back on the night Brenda and I go out to dinner for our anniversary. And being the wonderful husband that I am, I asked her to sit at Short Pump while I talked to him for 30 minutes. And she is such a gracious woman, she did, and I did not pay a high price for that. But we got to talk about the stuff that's going on, and he said, "Kevin, your worries are unfounded and stupid." I went, "Good, I'm glad. I wish I hadn't lost night's sleep over them." To seek God's wisdom, we got to learn some stuff that might be new. To seek God's wisdom, we got to be willing to pursue it. Over one of the doors, it was a quote from somebody, and I should know it because I graduated from the school and I walked under it every time I left the BSU and went up through Cabell Hall and over, maybe Cabell said it, I don't know. But it talked about the pursuit of truth. Guys, to find God's wisdom means to plumb the depths of understanding your salvation in Christ and what that means. To be bound for destruction and saved from that and made new in Christ Jesus changes everything. And it is the wisdom that we gather from that foundation. No matter how crazy the world gets, my salvation is sure. No matter how much I miss the will of God, my salvation is sure. No matter how much I get mad at the wrong things and don't get mad at the right things, my salvation is sure. No matter how down in the dumps I might get, no matter how many plans I might make and they be off track, my salvation is secured by the blood of Jesus Christ and the love that is in the heart of God the Father, who allowed that whole thing to unfold for you and for me. And it is wisdom when I apply that reality as the most informative piece of information to every decision, every emotion, every action of my life. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, oh, I wish wisdom was not so hard to acquire. Father, give me a heart that wants to know you, that'll pursue you with my whole heart. God, it doesn't mean that we don't do anything else in our lives, and we don't enjoy other things, but God, it means it's all covered with a heart that wants to know, love, and serve you. So God, I pray, in these challenging times we live in, that you'd help us pursue your wisdom. The wisdom that comes from the knowledge of your salvation. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. If you need to respond in some way to the Lord, I invite you to do that. Those of you that are here, you can come forward. You can respond right where you are so we don't have to break the social distance thing. That's not the point. Don't get lost in that. What you need to do is, if you need to talk to God about what was shared in God's Word today, then you need to talk to God. Don't leave this room without, don't say, "Oh, I'll talk to God tomorrow during my quiet time." Because if you're like me, you'll forget, what was church about Sunday? Right? It's just, you know, I don't think y'all remember this stuff forever and ever, right? It, the Lord speaks, and when He speaks, we have to respond, because when we respond, then we remember it better. So if you need to respond, pray with God and stay seated while we're singing, you do that. Online, if you guys need to respond, do it and do it now. Send us a message online. Shannon or I will give you a call if you need to talk to somebody. But if you were challenged to pursue God and His wisdom, and you need to kind of say to God, "Okay, God, I'm in," then would you do that today? Let's stand and sing. Thank you.
but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Father, we want you to show up. We want you to change our way of doing business. God, we want you to be the motivator. We want you to be the change agent. We want you to be the lead, the guide, the all-encompassing part of our lives that brings our strongly felt emotions and our deepest knowledge together into this wisdom that comes only from you. And Father, give us the heart to share and to put it into practice in our lives each day. And then you do what you will to change the world with it. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
The battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Amen. You guys have a great Sunday.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
You can use any exit.
You take what the enemy meant for evil,
turn it for good.
You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
Bridge 1B, one more time.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. The enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good.